It is you, Jesus, this is you. Jesus, you are greater than the grave. Jesus, you have broken every chain. Forever you will reign, forever we will sing. Jesus, this is you.
Conversations, all of those things that she hears and sees around the church is just phenomenal. God is working in powerful ways, and we're grateful for it. Grateful for what God is doing and how he's using each one of you to accomplish his purposes. And that's the great part. We are the body of Christ. And as the body of Christ, we all do it. We're all working together for his kingdom. Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 28, verses 6 through 9. Do it responsibly. Praise be to the Lord. The Lord is our strength and our shield. My heart leaps for joy, and with my song I praise him. A fortress of salvation for his anointed one.
Save your people and bless your inheritance. Be our shepherd and carry us forever.
Let's pray. Father, we're so grateful to you that you are our shepherd. You do carry us. You do guide us, and your blessings are upon us, and we're so grateful for you. Father, as we come before you as your body, we come before you as the body of Christ. We come before you as your church. And we say, first off, thank you. Thank you for all of your blessings. And we say, guide us in the worship this morning. Guide us to the words that we need to hear. Guide us into the, as we sing songs and praise and celebrate. Guide us. And then as we leave here, guide us into your place where you have us, to the people you want us to meet, to the places that we can make a difference for your kingdom. We thank you. So be with us over this next hour. Walk with us and speak to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Holy, holy, holy. Sherry, Ben, lead us as we remind about who God is first. Please be seated. As we come to our time of confession this morning, God continuously calls people to repentance. The world, the church, all are being called to return to the Lord. As followers of Jesus, we have sinned. We have followed our own ways and neglected our relationship with God. This morning, let's come in humbleness before God, admitting that we do stumble and fall. Hear the words of Hosea the prophet. Return, Israel, to the Lord your God. Your sins have been your downfall. Take words with you and return to the Lord. Who is wise? Let them realize these things. Who is discerning? Let them understand. The ways of the Lord are right. The righteous walk in them, but the rebellious stumble in them. Let's pray, first in the quietness of our own hearts, and then together. Let's pray together. Dear God, thank you for calling us to repentance, even when we feel we have no need, when we allow our own pride to think we are doing fine, when we go about our religious duties and neglect the most important relationship we have, the one with you. Forgive us, Father, when we look to other things to save us, our ideals, our political leanings, our education, our experiences, or our relationships. Forgive when we stray from your ways, when we allow our own minds and our own thoughts to cloud our view of you, when our own thoughts and feelings cause us to doubt you, doubt your care, or doubt the love of others that care for us and love us. Forgive us when we make idols of the things around us or the things we have made, when our convictions become more important than unity, when our things overwhelm us and take our eyes off you, when our jobs, our money, or our family overshadow you and draw us away from you. Forgive us when we attribute your care and guidance to other sources, when we fail to see the work of your hands as your continued provision, and take the credit for all ourselves. Forgive us when we stumble, when our rebellious nature gets the better of us and we fall. Thank you, Father, for your grace and mercy, that your forgiveness is clear and true. As your people, we return to you in humility and truth, knowing that we are forgiven, cleansed, and healed through the work of Jesus on the cross. Through his name we pray. Amen. We're so grateful, though, that God has forgiven us. And as Dutch, we come before him in worship. We need to be still and know that God is the one that we hear and listen to. Sherry, and yes.
Thanks,
Nicholas.
Oh,
8, and we're going to go from verse 27 to 9, verse 1. 9, verse 1. Follow along with me in your Bibles or up on the screen. Jesus and his disciples went on to the villages around Caesarea Philippi. On the way, he asked them, "Who do people say I am?" And they replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Peter answered, "You are the Christ." Jesus warned them not to tell anyone about it. He then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. He spoke plainly about this, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But when Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter. "Out of my sight, Satan," he said. "You do not have in mind the things of God, but the things of men." Then he called the crowd to him, along with his disciples, and said, "If anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for man to gain the whole world, yet forfeit his soul? Or what can a man give in exchange for his soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels." And he said to them, "I tell you the truth, some who are standing here will not taste death before they see the kingdom of God come with power." May God bless this, his word, to our hearts. My first question for you is this. Do you know who Jesus is? Do you know who he is? The disciples have spent a year and a half or so, maybe a little longer, and he asked them that question. They walked with him, they talked with him, they saw him. They were with him every day, hearing his words come from their mouth, his mouth, every day. And he asked them, "Who do you say Merriam-Webster defines an aha moment as a moment of sudden realization, inspiration, insight, recognition, or comprehension. Now, some of you here are dog people. Dog people? Who are the dog people? And the cat people? Cat people. I don't think Kate was a cat person before Dana moved home, but now she's a cat person. What's that? So she loves Ming, her Siamese. And Kate puts her hand up like a cat person. But some of us are dog people, some of us are cat people. And here's a little story. A German shepherd, a Doberman, and a cat died. In heaven, they faced a God who wanted to know what they believed in. The German shepherd said, "I believe in discipline, loyalty, and training to my master." "Good," said God. "You may sit on my right side." The Doberman said, "I believe in love, care, and protection of my master." "Good. You may sit on my left side," said God. Then God looked at the cat and said, "And what do you believe in?" The cat replied, "I believe you are sitting in my seat." Aha moments. Sometimes, Doug, you can use that one, okay? Because I think that would go well with me. Sometimes we have those aha moments. Now, I'm not saying that was an aha moment that God had when the cat said, "We were sitting in my seat." But we have aha moments. Time to go, "Oh, I get it. I get it. I understand." That moment of realization and that time when, whether it's something we've done, something we've said, something that we've been trying to understand, we get it. Maybe it was in school, or high school, or elementary school, or perhaps in university, and go, "Ah, now I understand what that means. I get it. and make sense to me. No, all of our journeys, we are going to have these kind of aha moments. Probably the most aha moment that we often have is the one that we see Peter having here in Mark chapter 8 and chapter 9. That aha moment when he recognized and realized who Jesus really was. That was an aha moment. That was a moment that Merriam-Webster would be really proud of to define. Because all of a sudden, Jesus got it. Jesus, or Peter, got it. You know, as we've been walking through the book of Mark, Mark has been an uphill climb to this point. This is the climax, something called the climax. It is the peak of Mark. It's when, at this point, everything is leading towards trying to have people understand who Jesus is. Not what they want him to look like, not what they think he should look like, but who he actually is. And then from this aha moment that Peter has, it begins the gradual descent to the cross. This becomes the mountaintop experience for them. This is the point where they get it, where it makes sense. And now Jesus has to bring on the harder stuff that comes along with it. So why does this matter to us? It's that time when we fully get it. Often we will point to that period in our life where we bowed our head in submission to God and said, Lord, I give you my life. Would you come in? Would you come and make me one of your children? We call that our conversion moment. This would be, I think, Peter's conversion moment. Because I think we recognize here that people do not come, they do not come out of nowhere and then come to Jesus. Some come really quickly, and we see that. But the reality is God works in the hearts and minds of people for a long time, bringing them to that point where they say, ah, I get it. Oh, I understand. And that's the point where we say, that's the time I made my commitment to Jesus. That's the time where I said, I'm going to follow you, Jesus, because I trust you. Peter is at that spot. He had followed Jesus for a year and a half or so, but God had been working on him. And as we've looked over the story over the last number of months, we've discovered over and over again where they just missed the point. They didn't get it. Even to the point where Jesus looks at them and says, are you still so dull? He's almost like saying to them, come on, guys, get with it. I can't be any more clear. So Jesus and the disciples are wandering around. And of course, he asks a simple question. Who do people say I am? You should almost be able to see that coming. You can almost see the question coming. Who do people say I am? This is important for us to understand. According to the people, and the common theme of the time is that Jesus was some kind of a messenger. That's what people thought. And the reality is, up until this point, up until the birth of Jesus, everybody who came, whether it was a prophet, whether it was a priest, whatever, every one of them came along, was some form of a messenger, speaking the good news that Jesus would bring as the Messiah. So they talk about a number of them. They talk about John the Baptist being the most recent. They talk about Elijah being one of the most prominent in Israelite history. Or they talk about some of the prophets. And they go, it's got to be one of these. That somehow Jesus has come back. But do you notice something strange about that? In every case, they still see him as a messenger. They still see Jesus as somebody who is preparing the way for someone else. They're unwilling to see Jesus for who he really is. He's a great God, a good teacher, a rabbi. But they haven't drawn the connection. They haven't made the connection yet. So he turns that picture back to the disciples. And I understand. He's saying to them, you guys have spent a lot of time with me. Who do you say? I love Peter because Peter is as brash and bold and committed as a flower that will fade in the morning. beautiful at times, but then sometimes it washes away. But I love Peter, because I see myself in Peter a lot. Peter stands right up and he says, you are the Christ, or you are the Messiah. Simple as that. But in that moment, in that brief period of time, that aha moment came to him and he said, and Jesus knew that he had got it. He recognized that he had got it. You are the Messiah. Now, for this to understand it a little bit better, the idea of Christ, he says, you are the Christ. Some of our Bibles might say Christ, some might say Messiah. And the two are basically the same. Christ is the Hebrew, and if it's Messiah, it would be Messiah in Hebrew, which is Messiah, translated into Greek, would be Christ. So it's the same thing. He's not telling you two different things, and our translations don't have two different competing ideas. It's the same thing. The idea was that Peter was looking at Jesus and said, you are the Messiah. And that idea that you have been chosen by God, consecrated for his service, and endued with power to accomplish the task. Peter saw that Jesus had a special role. He just wasn't one of the messengers that came along. But there's also political aspects that goes along with this. The word anointed one became an important part of this. It's bothering me today.
Or why, sure.
Is that?
For sure.
Normally it's not a problem, but today it's bothering me. Anyways, besides that. There were some very significant aspects that went along with this. There was political and national aspects that went along with it. When people saw the Messiah, they thought, here comes our political redeemer. Here comes the one who's going to free us up from the bonds of the Romans and allow us to be a true nation once again. This Messiah is going to come and he is going to ride in on a steed with weapons at hand, and he is going to defeat the Romans. So the political aspects that was there to that, and national aspects, that somehow he was going to be there for the Jews, but he wasn't necessarily going to be there for anybody else, unless they wanted to become a Jew. And then he was going to be there for them too. So this is the national aspects that were there, the nationalism and the political aspects that are part of around this, around the title of the Messiah. And so this is the thing that Peter gets hold of. Peter gets it. He goes, he's the Messiah. Yeah, he's going to come in. Yes, Jesus, you're going to defeat our foes. You're going to rescue Israel. And you're going to set us up as the reigning country again in this world. And power and authority and great things are going to come out of this. Right? How many times do you think that about Jesus? How many times if we only get a Christian leader in Ottawa? Oh boy, that's going to be great. We've had Christian parties, the Christian Heritage Party, I think, is still around. We've had Christian leaders come up through them. The reality is that still thinking the way Peter was thinking? Still thinking the way the disciples were thinking and many people were thinking? Well, we can go to a companion passage over in Matthew chapter 16. I'm not going to do that, but there's a little bit more expanded. So go there. Matthew 16, verses 13 to 20, has a little bit more drawn out, a little more expanded aspect to this particular period in Jesus' life. But there's something that takes place in Peter as he recognizes the Messiahship of Jesus. I believe Peter at this point isn't necessarily seeing the political, although it's part of it. Isn't necessarily seeing the nationalistic aspect, although that's part of it. Peter was voicing the words that Paul wrote in Romans 10. If you confess with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart, you will be saved. At that moment, Peter was confessing who Jesus was. At that moment, Peter was using his words and telling Jesus, this is who you are. What Paul would ask us to do as believers, Peter was already doing well before Paul was able. He was already speaking what Paul was asking. But we need to get an understanding of this confession. It is a significant leap of faith to understand the idea of Messiah. Because if you look at the time, the political time, the idea of Messiah was they would come in, and there would be mass healings, there would be beatings of many, and people would be freed from the oppression of the Romans. That was the way the Jews saw it. Well, 9,000 people or more, maybe 18,000 people being fed over a couple of different meals, that's pretty significant, right? Healings, yes, there's been a number, of course. Political oppression, freedom from political oppression? Not so much. The Romans were still the boss. They were still the ones, and Jesus wasn't doing anything like that. And that was the idea that was going to be there. Oftentimes, there was a lot of writing around the political aspects, that this Messiah would come as the one who would free and triumph and be the one who would set things right again. But I want us to see this. Peter's aha moment was step A. It was the first of many steps that Peter would have. Many times that Peter would be on the highs and on the lows. Probably the low was when he stood outside of the house and watched Jesus be tortured and denied knowing him. The low was when the cock crowed three times. The high was when he met with Jesus on the beach and Peter was restored. A high was when Peter was on the steps of the synagogue and he preached his sermon in Acts chapter 2. The high, can't hear me? Thank you. I don't control that. Thank you though for doing that, for telling me. I don't know it, I can't hear it. So the high was when Peter had these intimate aspects of being with Jesus. That's where the high is. But those were his later steps. Jesus was preparing Peter for what he would do as he moved along, as he grew and developed. Maybe I see myself in Peter. Maybe you see yourself in Peter. Because there are going to be the highs and the lows. Maybe you remember times when things were going really well and you were excited about all the things that God was doing. Perhaps like now, here in our congregation. Maybe perhaps you felt like you had let him down massively. That Jesus couldn't love me. That's part of following Jesus. That's part of recognizing that we are mere humans. That's human. So, the next point that goes on, because Peter's left here at this point, and he's excited, everything's going well, and it's like, yeah. And Jesus continues on. Then he began to teach that the Son of Man must suffer. He must die. And on the third day, he rose again. Wait a minute, Jesus. That has got nothing to do with nationalistic fervor, overthrowing the government. Exactly. So Peter stands up. No. This isn't going to happen. No, it's not going to happen. So Jesus turns to Peter, and very clearly says, get behind me, Satan. What you're saying is of human and not of divine origin. Just nanoseconds before, he had recognized who Jesus was. He had had a divine moment of, And a moment later, he's saying, no, it's not going to happen. Jesus wanted to let them know that it wasn't about nationalism. It wasn't about pride. It wasn't about overthrowing the Romans. It was about something completely different. It was about him going to the cross. It was about him suffering. It was about him dying. Because Jesus didn't just see Israel. Jesus saw beyond Israel and saw everything bigger. When Jesus was going to the cross, he didn't just see what was happening in the little spot there in the middle of the Middle East at that time. But he saw each one of you sitting here. He saw the way you would come to Jesus. He saw your growth, your development as a child of his. He saw all of that and he says, this is what I am doing. Going to the cross, taking away the sins of humanity is all that I am about. nationalistic fervor, saving people from their sins. He uses a term called Son of Man. He says, the Son of Man must suffer many things, be rejected by the elders, chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and must be killed, and after 3 days rise again. Notice the words in there. Must, must, must. Jesus already knew what his future held. And he wanted those disciples that were sitting around that, who had just had that, to realize they must witness that and very likely suffer that if they're following him. That's not fun. That doesn't fill pews. That doesn't encourage people to follow. If I were to say that, you must, as Jesus did. Some of you might be right up and over. Sorry, I don't want to do this. I didn't sign up for that. I didn't sign up for being tortured and punished. I didn't sign up for being hurt. I didn't sign up to die. I signed up because you're going to save the world, Jesus. And I want to be part of that. That's what Peter came across. The Son of Man must suffer. Must. It's a messianic secret that Jesus had, and now he's revealing. And to this point, he's kept it quiet. He's kept it to himself. And now he says, this is what's going to happen. This is the next stage. And Peter says, no, you can't do that. Peter is both taking it personally, and he's a representative. Peter was the one that said it. But the reality was, is he was a representative, because what he spoke, more people were feeling around that circle. But my guess is that as he spoke, we all can identify with that. We all want our faith to lead to bigger and better things, more wonderful things. We want it to get better. We want our time to get better, we want our church to get better, we want everything to go better. But we don't think about the tough things that come along in life. Because as Jesus said, I'm going to go, I'm going to suffer, and I will die and rise again. He was also saying that about his followers. And they did. That's not exactly something that's attractive. But that's the reality that Jesus came to do. So it's as if to say, Peter, don't take it personally. But he did take it personally, because he was the one that put mouth it. But many others probably also felt it. It reminds us very clearly that there are two different ways that God's plans might be thwarted unknowingly by good people, by religious people. Peter was a religious person. He was a follower. And yet he was wanting to take Jesus' plans away. He was wanting to do that. No, Jesus, we care for you. We don't want to lose you. No. We have to watch out for that. Satan tries to derail God's plans and purposes by using people to stand up. And he also tries to stop them by saying that every way that Satan moves, we've got to find some way to counter it. The reality is, that fight that was between Satan and Jesus was something that only Jesus and Satan could engage in. We are all fallout. But Jesus was dealing with Satan, not with Peter. And sometimes in our own lives, in our own church, in our own families, good people who follow Jesus can say the wrong things, do the wrong things, and hurt people in the meantime. That's a reality. And we recognize that it's not coming from God, but that Satan can even use and manipulate us. Maybe you've been a part of it. Somebody you trusted is gossiping about you. That hurts. Says something negative about you. That hurts. We recognize that's the case. Peter did take it personally. In verse 34, at the beginning of chapter 9, verse 1, Jesus begins to demonstrate the way of the cross. He says, this is my path, what I'm going to have to do. And now he says, this is what you're going to have to do. This is going to be what's required of you. The audience changed. Now it's not just the disciples, but it's the disciples and everybody else around them. But what interesting takes place is as he talks, he's no longer mincing words. He's not worried about who hears this. He's now saying it outright and plainly. This is what's going to be required. The actions of a disciple, taking up one's cross and following Jesus. That's the actions of a disciple. And as those disciples were there, he said, that's what you're going to have to do. Taking up your cross as they would have done down the Via Dolorosa in Jerusalem, going up to Calvary. Jesus himself would walk that. And he knew that everyone who follows him would have to walk a similar path. Not in the same place or in the same time. But taking up our cross is so important. The actions of the disciple require us to bear our cross. And the picture of that man who, when condemned, carries his cross. The Christians that were in Rome when this was written and sent to had understood that and saw that and go, yep, that's what we're doing. Then he goes on to talk about a few other things that all relate back to taking up one's cross and following Jesus. Loving and saving. Or losing and saving. He says, do you want to lose your life? Then give it up for me. Do you want to save your life? Then you'll lose it in the end. Do you want to have your soul and the value of the soul? Follow. If you don't follow, you will lose it. Losing and saving. And that's completely different. The things that we value, we keep trying to keep close to our hearts, close to our minds, close to our bodies. You have your car keys in your purse or in your pocket. Because if you lose your car key, you can't start your car, and you value your $40,000 car. Right? You value it. You keep your house keys close to you, and you only give them to people you trust because you value it. Sometimes we value our heart and say, I'm not going to let my heart get hurt. I'm not going to get myself in a place where I'm going to be hurt. I'm not going to change the chance of losing. I'm going to value it. And Jesus says, give it away. It's not yours anyways. Give your heart away. Give your mind away. Give your soul away. That's the walk of the disciple. That's what Jesus asks us to do. For it doesn't matter if you die and you've lost your soul. You're not anyways. What does it matter? The question comes back to us again is this. Who do you say Jesus is? A good man? Messenger? A good teacher? Nice guy? Or the Messiah who asks us to sacrifice and follow him? Who do you say Jesus is? Let's pray. Father, thank you that we can look into you. Thank you that we can see what you want us to see. God, there are times when none of us want to follow the way of the disciple. There are times when we don't want to hear that. We don't want to see that. And maybe right now is one of those times. Give us the strength to walk the way of the disciple. The way of the follower of you who is willing to carry the cross and go where you go. Give us the strength to live to do so. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The great thing about what took place there, the shadow of Mount Hermon, was that God was given the glory. And God is given the glory when we turn ourselves over to him. And we say, take us, we will follow. God always gets the glory. Jared and Venus.
Glory, great dignity, and hope.
flash of red. Battery flashes red. It's an aha moment. Well, it's true. You're not supposed to lick it, are you?
Yeah.
Well,
not very good.
Well, I think Ken, the batteries you bought 10 or 11 or 12 years or whatever, it was, I think they're finally buying a bullet.
You're on Amazon.
There we go, now we have it. As we come to our time of prayer this morning, a couple of things that we want to pray about, or praise God for this morning. We had our meeting last night downstairs, and there was something in my almost 14 years of being in this church that I have not seen before. Now it's coming at the end of May. We had a surplus in our budget. We had a deficit for how long we're here. God is doing something powerfully, and we were great. I looked at the bottom and I said, there's no negative sign beside the roof. Just positive. I mean, it means we brought in more money than we spent in the last 5 months. I mean, that's wonderful. It's great. And we praise God for that. I want to share that with you. And that's just a result of the joy that we have. And Erin's not here today. She said, I have a dream. I said, what's that? She said, well, my mom was still around. Her mom died a few years ago. She said, but we came to the church and there was no room for us to get in. I don't know what that means. It's just, she said, I had this dream. And Jenny said something to her. I said something about, well, see it, when we see that come true, something like that. But it was just, God is doing something. We're so grateful for what God is doing. And having a budget that's in the surplus is amazing. Great, all the praise goes to God, and all thanks go to Him. But we also know that as we serve Him and we do the things that God asks us to do, God always provides for every way. So we're grateful for that. As we come to our time of prayer, I want to thank God that Doug is back with us. Doug had surgery on Wednesday, and he's not quite walking his mile a day, but he's getting close to it. Doug?
Just like every brother has done the prayer, so they were surprised by my doing. So I'm pretty sure we're praying for you.
That's absolutely. We're praying for you. On Wednesday, we prayed for you. We're praying for you through the week, too. So we're grateful that Doug's back with us again today. So it's wonderful to see you, Doug. Other things we can pray for or praise God for today?
Stacy's mother.
Oh, yes. Stacy has been coming off and on over the last year and a half or so. Her mom had, Mom Jocelyn had a stroke just this past week. Stacy's a little older than I am. Not Stacy. Her mom's a little older than I am, probably in her early 60s. And so she's recovering. Looks like she'll be able to get back home again real soon, but she's in the hospital in Stratford. Asks for prayer. So the woman's name is Jocelyn. And Jocelyn's a great woman. Had a chance to have her Bible study a number of times, so she's wonderful. Other things we can pray for, praise God for today.
A praise item for Jim's parents' place is completely entertained. Yeah, and we moved what Martha wanted over to Harbor Hill. So
the house is empty. I know a bunch of it came over here for the yard sale. So. And that's good. It's a lot of work off your shoulders, isn't it, Jim? You know, have that taken care of. But we continue to pray for Martha as she continues to recover and get restored. Other things we can pray for?
Great.
Yeah, we'll pray for the families of those five people that died in that submersible accident this past week. You know, just the idea of it's enough. Anyways, pray for them, pray for the families. I'm sure they didn't want to be mourning a husband or a father or a son, and they are today. Yeah. Absolutely. Other things we can pray for? Jerry.
Well, part of it is prayer, part of it is praise. My daughter-in-law, one of the results came back that she had a lump on the breast, but it's okay, it's not cancer.
Excellent.
She still has things on the lungs, and they had to figure out what the things in the lungs are, yeah, so still praise her.
What was her name again?
Allie.
Kelly.
Allie.
Ellie. Praise for praise for Kelly and for Ellie having no cancer in the breast, but still uncertain about what the other the lungs. Okay. Definitely pray for that. Yes?
I pray for Angel and
Will
and Jennifer and Health Issues.
Okay, got Lillian and another girl that joins Building for Health Issues. Angel. And I'd ask for prayers for Sherry and I as we have a fun vacation this week. That we can forget about it. No offense. But we can just relax and rest. There's nothing worse than saying, oh, I've got to keep on thinking about what's going on. Hopefully everything will be good for the next 2 weeks. But we're going to be enjoying ourselves away for a little bit of time. So we ask for prayers that God will allow us to just relax and rest. Let's come before God, shall we, this morning. Father, thanks so much for your goodness and grace to us. Father, for the things that we have before us, we lift in prayer. For Jocelyn, for Lillian, for Angel, for Martha. Father, we praise you that you are working in these situations, however you are. You are touching brains that have been hurt, bodies that are aging. You are touching those who don't know what the doctors don't know yet. And the confusion that goes along with that, and the worry that goes along with that. We pray, Father, that you would be with each one of these folks as they continue to heal. Father, may they follow the instructions of their doctors, but also know that you are the one that brings healing. You are the one that restores the body. You set that in motion thousands of years ago. Father, thank you for your healing touch that you lay on many of us. Thank you. Father, we pray for the comfort as well. Comfort for those who've lost. We think of the families of the RCR regiment in Petawawa who've lost in an accident. We pray that you be with them, help them, encourage them, strengthen, comfort them in only ways that you can comfort them, Father. And as well, Father, for those families who lost their lives in the South and the Atlantic. Again, we don't understand what they're going through, but you do. And may your comfort be there with them, through them, all of their life. Comfort them and encourage them with your spirit. Father, we also want to be reminded that while not everybody believes that we believe, but we know that your comfort is universal. Your comfort will touch people no matter what. And in that, you can lead people to know who you are. So Father, bring into their lives people who will encourage them, and strengthen them and share with them about the good news of Jesus. That even in death, life is still possible. So Father, we thank you for that. Father, we do want to pray for Ellie and thank you for good news for her. But not only good news, knowing that there's still some stuff that's not certain. We pray for her and comfort her as she waits for that, that information to come through. Father, we're so grateful to you, Lord. Grateful to you for times of holidays and relaxation and vacation. Thank you that we can spend the time with Sherry and I get away for a couple of weeks. Help me let go and relax and not try to control. Help me to let go. Father, thank you for a great meeting last night. Thank you for a surplus that I've never seen before in our works. But you have, and you have provided in phenomenal ways through your people. Father, never let us forget that it comes from you and you only, as you supply our needs. Father, guide us as a church. Guide us as we seek to be the people of God to this community and this neighbor to our neighborhoods. Father, may we show Jesus to others. Thank you for what you're doing in us. Father, we do pray. We thank you for Jim's mom's house being sold and emptied and all the work that has gone into that. And I'm sure For them, watching emptying the house of memories is always a challenge. But thank you, Father, that is taken care of. And I thank you that Martha is settling in at Harbor Hills. Help her to get better as well. Father, we thank you for Jocelyn, and I pray for her. We ask that you be with her. She's struggling with recovery, weak arm. Be with her as she recovers. Father, thank you for the woman of faith that she is. Father, we thank you for this time we've spent together. Thank you for your speaking to us in very powerful ways. We ask all of this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Just a few announcements for this week. Sherry and I will be Bob will be speaking next week and the week after. Dave will be leading worship with Joanne and Ken next week. And then Ken and Marie Flynn will be here next week. So in 2 weeks, and Ken and Marie will be leading worship. So it'll be a great time together. And I will miss being with you and look forward to being back with you again on the 9th, 16th of July. So keep us in your prayers. This week, Bible study will be taking place at Wednesday at 1:30, and Sean will be leading Bible study this week. And Joanne is going to be leading prayer meeting on Thursday at 1:30 as well. So if you feel like coming, come out and to both of those and have some great times together. And I think that's all the announcements. Any announcements that I may have missed, Dorothy? No? Okay, thank you. Then let's prepare to leave. Prepare to go out into the world where God has called us. We may be leaving this spot, but we are entering into the ministry and the mission field that God has called us to. And we're recognizing that God is building his kingdom here. And he's doing it through you and through me. Sherry, man, lead us.
Thank you.
and go out into the world in which God has called us. We want to remind them that we're all having coffee and tea downstairs and then some praise downstairs. And one thing I did forget to mention earlier is that we're still looking for people who are willing to supply and host for the coffee hour after church. And the sign up is at the back. Please feel free to fill out some of those. All the dates are there from now through December. And there's a lot of empty lines. Now let's go. Let's go into our world. Go to the people God has called you. Go and speak the words that God gives you. Go and be Jesus to the neighborhood, to your family, and to those He's called you. But go. Go in His name and in His power. Amen.